Well, I want to first say thank you to Coann and the group for assembling a living room rather than forcing me over to the lectern, because so often I think that in the sustainability space, we suffer from a tone of lecture and rather than simple storytelling between friends, right? And so the opportunity to place myself in a living room to tell a story about the work we're doing at Levi's to a bunch of friends, I think is the right tone, because this needs to be an easier pill to swallow than we often make it. And so let me start by saying who I am and what I do. I'm Paul Dillinger. I'm head of product innovation. It's a fancy way of just saying I'm a fashion designer. What I want to tell you about is the way at Levi's, where the design role provides a path towards solutions in ways that we often don't expect design to function. When we think about design, most of the time, there. We decorate things. We balance colors and patterns, and we deliver value to the consumer by making things pretty. That's normally, that's normally the way we think about the role of design. But in fact, the image on the screen shows the design value that Levi Strauss brought to consumer goods. There are a bunch of silver miners up in the gold fields of California around the time of the gold rush, and Levi Strauss was a dry goods purveyor to those men, giving them the supplies they needed to do their job. One of the supplies was cotton workwear pants that were ripping out. There was this opportunity to take copper rivets, as you see there in the image, and to put those two pieces of copper together on either side of the fabric that was tearing to create a point of strength where there had been a point of weakness. This was the original innovation that provided the opportunity for success that defines the Levi Strauss brand: consumer value through durability, lasting value. Now, what happened then was success. And whenever you have a good idea to deliver consumer value once you become successful to do it 1 million, 10 million, 100 million times over and over again, you often fail to realize what the downstream impact of all that success is going to be. Whenever we think of a good idea, whoever invented that cell phone, would they have thought about maybe designing it a little differently, innovating towards a different direction that didn't rely on, say, rare earth? If they imagined that every person on the earth would get one of these, they probably would have looked for mineral solutions that weren't quite as problematic to procure. Similarly, when we think about the making of this one object, when we consider the massive scale at which we make it, the success that it's enjoyed over the last 140 years, I think we would have possibly thought differently about how we went about making it. But we don't come to those conclusions until after we've enjoyed tremendous success, which is not the worst problem to have. But what we've ended up doing is creating across our supply chain a variety of different points of impact that had been unanticipated when we first designed the object. We've taken some time now after 140 years of reflection to go through, and we just completed the second comprehensive life cycle assessment of a pair of 501 jeans that looks at different categories of impact across the different points in the life cycle of the garment, and from the cotton cultivation, the fabric creation, the fabric assembly and garment manufacturing process, shipping operations, consumer use and end-of-life considerations. All of this is very good information, important information to have, and the granular information just went live on our website for our new life cycle assessment. But like I said, I'm a designer, fundamentally an arranger of pillows on a sofa. What does all of this mean? It's somewhat abstract when presented to the design function of any company in these terms. So what I'm going to talk about is a new way of considering what it is that I do. I'm a designer. I go in every day. I say, I'm going to design a great new pair of jeans that's going to make someone's butt look great. It's going to be real comfortable. And it's going to create about 3,800 liters in water consumption and about 34 kilograms of CO2 impact, right? That's a wholly different proposition than the arranging of pillows on a sofa. It's a wholly different proposition than the conventional understanding of the role of a fashion designer. But it is, in fact, what we do. And the designer and maker of anything, whoever designed and made the phone in your pocket, made more than that phone. They made all the the upstream supply chain waste and pollution, potentially all the downstream recycling challenges. They made a phone, and they made these other areas of impact. And once you, as a designer or maker of things, understand your role, it's not just the delivery of consumer value, but also the generator of these types of impact, you go to work with a very different agenda. You go to work saying, okay, rather than designing that jean that makes my butt look great and the 3,800 liters of water consumption and 34 kilograms of carbon output, what if I try to draw those levels of impact down? What are the ways that I can do that? And once you set that challenge to yourself as a designer, great looking butt, right, and reduced water consumption, there's a tremendous unlock. When you put the creative mind of a designer to a challenge like that, all we want to do in life is problem solve. And if we can problem solve around things like the consumption of water, real value can be generated. A few years ago, we started this crazy notion of how do we wash jeans to use less water or no water. Part of the creation of the assortment diversity is the finishing of our jeans to achieve different levels of blue. Now that's done using a series of laundry processes. Those laundry processes consume tremendous amounts of water, and we asked ourselves, can we wash without water? And 4 years ago, we put that proposition to ourselves, to our supply chain, to our suppliers. And about a month ago, we were able to quantify the impact over 4 years of this modified production and redesigned production cycle. And we were able to deliver a billion liters of fresh water saved over 4 years. Not bad work for a bunch of fashion designers who heretofore had only thought about, you know, making the butt look good. So when I think about my mother, who always said, well, gosh, it's nice that you're a fashion designer, but boy, couldn't you have been a doctor? And I think about the tremendous tragedy that has occurred in Nepal and the appeal from the Red Cross. What do you really need? Well, we need all the help we can get, but what we really need right now is some water. It makes me feel a little bit better about the job that I do, knowing that I work at a company that can facilitate this kind of impact just by taking responsibility for its own resource consumption and investing in cultivating the knowledge about that consumption. In saving a billion liters in the finishing, we know that that's only carving out impact in one area of the life cycle. A tremendous amount of water is consumed at the consumer stage after it's been bought and after it's being cared for. And how do we influence an area where we don't have control? To that end, we've started putting out tools like this one to the consumer that say, you know, if your activity accounts for 23% of the water consumed over the life of this garment, and that is 23% of the 3,700 liters that the garment will use over its life, you have a big piece of responsibility here. But let's give you the tools to calculate exactly how much water you're using as you care for your product, and allow yourself to benchmark against about other consumers, against the norms geographically, so that we can give people the tools to help understand how they can be participants in a solution where heretofore they've been ignorant participants in the problem, kind of the same way the designers have. And it's a really exciting initiative that puts out to the consumer some friendly reminder of their own responsibility in cultivating a more sustainable future for consumer goods, for consumption. So all of these initiatives that recalibrate areas of impact are important, but there are other stories that are important for designers to engage in. And one of those areas of need is consideration of the communities where we operate. We sell globally and we manufacture globally. And every place that we manufacture, we have something in place called the Terms of Engagement that was launched about 25 years ago. It was a way of standardizing and enforcing expectations of fair labor and environmental stewardship in every facility where we do business. There was a real concern at the beginning of this process that it would create a competitive disadvantage for us, that we would be putting ourselves at disadvantage by expecting a standardized norm globally, regardless of region. And what it in fact did was it compelled the rest of the industry to follow. We found that where we led with our values, the rest of the industry followed. Where we led with courage around our belief in fair labor and environmental stewardship, it created a new norm. But what it also did is it created a group of facilities where the fair labor practices made the communities or the citizens around them want to work in Levi's certified factories above other factories. It created this sort of magnetic pull towards these certain factories where our fair labor practices had become norm, such that false communities started to emerge. There's an example of a little village of 11,000 called Quanament in Haiti that when a Levi's confirmed factory went up near that village, it suddenly surged to around 38,000 people. Well, it didn't have the water infrastructure, right, to support that many people. It didn't have the educational infrastructure, financial services infrastructure, but people were flocking there because there were good jobs. And it begs the question, what is the role of the company, what's the responsibility for the company to address the quality of the workers' lives outside the factory walls? And that consideration prompted the creation of a new pilot initiative called Improving Workers' Well-Being, where we're partnering with some of our best factories, carving out a portion of our cost of goods, investing it in a fund along with the factory. The fund is managed by in-country NGOs who are asking the question of the workers, what community development projects do you need? And we're directing our funding towards the answers to those worker-administered surveys. So that in factories like the one I described in Haiti, where the need was identified by the people in those factories of public water infrastructure development, our industrial footprint is now funding the cultivation of new ways of delivering fresh water. It costs money, yes, but what it returns is to a factory where we have around a 30% absenteeism rate due to dysentery among the workers, because they don't have access to fresh water, the immediate business value of eliminating that form of absenteeism, it makes the program more than paying for itself. It provides a fundamental net positive to the community. So the question is, how do we link all of these opportunities, the opportunity to create social value through our business engagement, the opportunity to conserve natural resources, but also the obligation to continue to deliver to the consumer the quality product that they know and love without a change in price and without a change in consumer experience. And so I give you on the screen two jean jackets, right? They're fundamentally the same jean jacket, a trucker jacket, an icon created by Levi Strauss in the early part of the 20th century that's been fundamentally consistent all the way through. We always like to talk about the company delivering goods that are the same as always, like never before. And here's a good story of like never before. This is the first product that's coming out, it's launching this fall, that's put through what we call the WellThread design methodology that seeks to create either environmental or social value creation at every point in the production process that allows the design team to simply make the right choice whenever a choice can be made. The difference between these two isn't readily evident, except that it's different in every way. From the ethically sourced cotton fiber that was cultivated using cultivation methods that drastically draw down on the amount of water, herbicide, pesticide, and fertilizer that's necessary to cultivate. The fabric itself was created at a mill that has worked with us to unlock a new way of dyeing that uses half the water that conventional dyeing uses. To the waterless processing that I described earlier that's netted that $1 billion in freshwater savings. A material strategy here on the garment that's on the right-hand side of the screen, you'll see it doesn't look terribly different, except every component that's in that garment is either an extractable metal or 100% cotton, whereas the garment on the left uses stronger polyester thread. It uses a leather-like label. It has interfacings that are polyester. Now, all of those are accommodations to production process that were appropriate at the time that the accommodation was made, but we wanted stronger thread so we could put more aggressive processing on it. We needed a polyester red tab so that we could do finishes that might otherwise damage the tab and turn it pink. Well, maybe we shouldn't be doing those finishes. Maybe if it's a finishing process that might turn that little red tab pink if it's made of cotton and we have to change it to polyester, maybe we shouldn't be doing the processing instead of changing the materiality of the label. Now, these are all nuanced little changes, and they might seem like sort of paltry, insignificant little modifications, but the fact is the introduction of mixed fiber into the production process creates, in a recycling scenario, product that can never be upcycled or same-cycled. It must be downcycled. The polyester thread, the polyester trim, the polyester labeling, the polyester interfacing, all of that is a pollutant into a future state of recycling that then precludes us from finding useful value in the second, third, and fourth generation life of the cotton fiber, whereas the garment on the right has had all mixed fibers eliminated, in doing so, we've had to accommodate, modify our process, and we can't use the same aggressive finishes that we might use on the old way of making. In doing so, we're also eliminating some chemistry from our supply chain that maybe shouldn't be there in the first place. We're pulling back on the aggression that we deploy in washing the garment to get the diverse looks like the one you see here on my knee, pulling back on some of the more on any of the finishing that might degrade the useful value of the garment, and in doing so, have a garment that represents a pure input to a future state recycling scenario that will allow us to find upcycle value in the second life and third life and fourth life of that garment. And it's a really complex story. It's kind of in the weeds. It's a little bit, as we say, inside baseball. There are kind of a nerdy little design details that no one else should care about. But when you pull back and you tell this complete story about water savings in the field, in the mill, in the factory, material choices that allow for useful redeployment at the end of life. And then if you start assembling all of those components in a way so that they can only go to those factories where we are creating social value through public water infrastructure creation, we end up with a collection of garments that collectively looks kind of like the Levi's you've always known and loved, kind of like the product that you always expected from us. But each individual piece in this new collection has a rich and complex story to tell about the consciousness that went into every point of decision making. From a jean jacket here that uses cotton that was grown color as a khaki colored cotton, so that no water ever had to be used in the dyeing of that garment, so that it was basically born that way, to a jean here that was made using waterless denim, using waterless finishing, but was made at a factory in Bangladesh where the production of that jean contributes to the funding of financial literacy education and financial services access to a population of women workers who've never known what a savings account or equity development was. Each of these garments has a different story to tell, just as rich and complex as the story of that jean jacket, down to the button on that Western shirt that's made out of recycled post-consumer cotton, hand-dyed in indigo, so that we know exactly where that button will end up. It'll end up as a single part of a single fiber strategy when that garment is at the end of its life and it gets recycled. The button doesn't act as a pollutant. The thread isn't a pollutant. It's entirely consistent in materiality. Each of these items has a really rich and complex story to tell. And the question is to the consumer, do you as consumers want to hear that story? And I believe that the consumer does want to hear that story. But if the consumer doesn't want to hear that story, if the consumer just wants to look good, and just wants their butt to look good in the Levi's jeans, we've got that covered too, because each of these pieces in this new collection is at cost parity with a conventionally made garment that it will be sold next to. Each of these pieces still looks as good as anyone would expect a pair of Levi's to look, but each one of them was made with a wholly new and different sort of set of conscious decision-making points around each of the components as they were assembled across every point in the product's life cycle. Now, this is a whole new way of making, and each of these new decisions is somewhat disruptive to a fairly conventional and unsophisticated supply chain that's used to doing business a certain way. And so the challenge that we have is to temper our appetite for radical change and to temper our appetite for immediate volume behind this sort of new way of making and allow ourselves to patiently and sort of thoughtfully, mindfully go forward with constrained scale. This is a small collection. We're making it available online where we have the best ability to tell the story of all of these funny little decisions that led us up to this point. So that the consumer that wants to read about it can wants to experience the fullness of the story can, but we're not expecting it to go to scale so quickly that we put any of these initiatives at risk for potential failure. Because I can tell you, all of the learning that went into the new Levi's Well thread was learning that happened from the launch of a Dockers Well thread about a year ago. I had a chance to speak at Sustainable Brands in San Diego about an exciting new product proposition, and put it bluntly, I hate to use the F word in this one, but that product proposition failed. It failed beautifully and fantastically in a way that taught us so much about the next iteration of this new way of making. This fantastic, beautiful, fabulous fashion failure made possible a much bigger launch of Levi's Well thread than we had for the Dockers Well thread a year ago. And had we not constrained our activity and been patient and mindful with our appetite for change, we would have gone too big too quickly, and that fabulous fashion failure would have put the sustainability initiatives at Levi Strauss perhaps in jeopardy. But instead, we gave ourselves a sandbox, as we like to call it, a laboratory for progress. so that we were able to keep small and constrained this dabbling, this testing and validating, so that when we encountered challenges in the market for whatever reason, that we were able to recontextualize the F word and make it something valuable and meaningful. And it's a difficult thing for me to admit, but yeah, I may have screwed up a little. And in doing so, was able to come back in the next season with something more meaningful, more textured, more, I think, richly productive. And that's the way that Levi Strauss & Company addresses progress. Everything we do is made of progress, and we're going to try to do it, as best as we can, we're going to try to do it right. So thank you for letting me share the story of the big F.